Good morning. Welcome to Core Java Lecture 7. I was explaining you OOP concepts. In that you have learnt about abstraction, encapsulation, inheritance. Today I'll explain you polymorphism. In Greek, poly means many, morph means form. So together you call polymorphism, and polymorphism stands for many forms. So polymorphism is a feature that allows one interface used for a general class of actions. The specification is determined by the exact nature of the situation. So let me explain you by taking an example. You see, you know the concept of stack, which you have come across in C and data structures, which is a data structure which stores data and works on principle of push. It pushes values into this stack and then pops out. Now here I'll consider three stacks: stack A, B and C. Stack A will hold integer values, stack B holds floating point numbers, and stack C holds character values. In case if you are working with non-object oriented language, we should write three different functions to handle these three stacks. So here the concept is same for the stack. For all these three, algorithm is same, but data types are different. In the case of non-object oriented language, we need to write three different functions, or you can call them as methods or routines, to work with these three stacks A, B and C by giving three different names. But because of this polymorphism, in Java we can specify a general set of stack routines that all share the same names. If all these three have the same name, then how can we decide which one to be used for integer, which one is for float and character? That is the job of the compiler, to select the specific action. Here, what do you mean by specific action? Method, as it applies to each situation. So this is called compile time polymorphism. During compile time, the compiler has to decide based on the data types which method has to be executed. Then what is the role of the programmer here? the programmer is relieved out of this complexity. The programmer need just to decide, make utilization of the general interface. He need not make the selection manually. So here, let me give you an example for much more clarification of this concept of polymorphism. Suppose I want to find out the area of a geometrical shape. If it is a square, to find out the area, the formula is S square. Input, we need to give only one value. If it is a rectangle, and to find the area, the formula is L into B, and input we need to give two values here. And we are going to write a class in that you are writing a method. That method is named as area. So area is the name of the method, and it returns by calculating area. This is defined for square, and you are writing another method, area, for rectangle, and it returns the area of the rectangle. Then both the method names are same. Then how can the compiler knows which method is to be called for square and which method is to be called for rectangle? If it is the case of the square, as you know, the formula is S square, the input will be S. And if it is rectangle, the input will be length and breadth. So based on the number of arguments and data types of, based on number of arguments and data types of arguments, compiler decides which method to be implemented, and this is called comes under compile time polymorphism. And this in detail in next coming lectures you will learn under method overloading. There is another type of polymorphism called runtime polymorphism that you will learn in detail under method overriding. So with this, all object-oriented programming concepts, important concepts, which are abstraction, encapsulation, inheritance and polymorphism, are covered in detail, and we will meet in the next session, that is lecture 8. Bye, take care.